Everyone, welcome. Today, we're continuing our exploration of positive, sustainable tokenomics design by looking at the concept of value accrual. Now, value accrual intersects with a number of points made on this earlier design manifesto that I put forward, but I'd say it mainly relates to this second point where I say we need to align asset supply with a fair estimate of fundamental value that is being created by or rooted through our economy. Now, value accrual deals with an important implicit assumption that's doing some work here. In order for this relationship between token supply and fundamental value to be relevant in the first place, we need some kind of link between our tokens and the pool of resources that is being created or funneled through our blockchain economy. So that's the topic that we're specifically going to dig into today. But first, we have a small celebration to acknowledge. This is officially my first YouTube video. All the material I've been uploading so far have been previews of an e-learning course that I'm creating. Actually, I still have a number of course previews left to share, but once that's done, from there on, I'll be making dedicated YouTube content once a week. This channel is still really new, and it's a bit daunting to be putting in this much time and energy into it, knowing that I'm still going to have to keep doing that for a good while before it even has a chance of becoming a success. So if you like this material, please do subscribe, share, and comment, start a discussion. It really, really helps the channel and honestly, my own motivation too. Now, I decided to make this video on value accrual because it's frequently referenced in tokenomics, but once I did some online research around it, I couldn't actually find a satisfactory definition for it. So I'm trying my own hand at tidying up the concept a little bit and bringing it into sharper focus. Now, as I've said, the term doesn't have a strongly settled definition yet, but from what I see, most of us in the tokenomic space have fairly consistent intuitions around it, so it should be accommodated by the following statement. Value accrual refers to the processes or mechanics that either endow, preserve, or build value in a digital token. Now, the dictionary meaning of accrual is closely associated with accumulation and buildup. But in a blockchain context, I don't think it's helpful to restrict ourselves to discuss mechanics that are aimed at progressively building value, because those same mechanisms can also be run to preserve digital asset value without appreciation. So I think it's more helpful to define value accrual as a general concept and describe the emphasis on preservation or appreciation as a policy choice that's exercised by the project. Of course, a project may pursue different policies during different phases of development or under different economic conditions. And those policies can be chosen at free discretion by authorities, by a shared governance process, or else be coded up as a blockchain-secured rule using smart contracts. Anywho, there are two broad methods for engineering value accrual. We can assign claims rights to our digital assets, or we can take monetary actions that change their scarcity in relation to a value pool that they have claimed to. We're going to look at each of these in turn. When it comes to claims rights, the concept originates in legal theory and typically describes a right holder being entitled to have a specific predefined claim satisfied when certain conditions are met. As a couple of rough examples here, consider the words printed on Bank of England money that references the time when this money was honored as a claim on other assets held by the bank. Or perhaps consider a transfer of title for a property, which confirms the new owner's rights to enjoy its benefits as their property. Now, legal theory posits these as relationships that have legal force, but legal force is not relevant to us today. I'm just borrowing the term, as it were, to talk about how we design digital tokens to give them a reliable claim to something else and to understand the impact that this has on their value. The beautiful thing about blockchain, of course, is if this claim is on some other blockchain asset, that claim can be verifiably secured and trustlessly executed to satisfaction with the use of cryptographically secured smart contract code. But we can also create token claim rights that are fulfilled the old-fashioned way through a trusted counterparty. And let's not get blinded by anarcho-libertarian fervor here. In many economies, these claims are fulfilled at very low risk, So much so that you don't waste so much as a nanosecond thinking about them whenever you make a new order from Amazon or when you renew your Netflix subscription. So there's nothing inherently wrong or problematic about using a blockchain token to define a right of claim without a smart contract or even to a non-blockchain or off-chain asset in the physical world. So how do these kinds of claim rights create an accrual of value? Well, let's take the simple case where the tokens are reliably redeemable for their underlying claims and they have no other utility. In a fair and informed exchange, they should be as valuable as the assets that they have claim to. If the tokens are more valuable than their underlying claims, that exchange would happen at a loss to the party giving up the tokens. And if the tokens are less valuable than their underlying claims, that exchange would happen at a loss to the party accepting the tokens. Simple. Okay, so let's just check in with what we've got so far. We can assign claims rights to our tokens, and these create value accrual if the underlying asset is valued and the satisfaction of claims is reliable. We said that the assets we assign to be claimable may be other blockchain assets, in which case these can benefit from being trustlessly secured and satisfied using smart contract technology. Or if they are other assets, digital or physical, the claims are then satisfied by some process that's managed by a trusted counterparty. Now, there's also another distinction that it's worth highlighting in a tokenomic context. And that's the distinction as to whether the goods and services claimed are sourced from within the digital asset economy itself or from outside of it. You'll sometimes hear economists and tokenomics specialists refer to these as endogenous and exogenous goods, respectively. These are fancy words that mostly serve to inflate our own sense of self-importance, but they are used, so no harm in you learning them. So why do we care about this distinction? Well, if the goods are endogenous, they will be generated by a process that occurs inside the digital asset economy itself. And in the best cases, this arrangement will successfully lever blockchain technology to reduce economic costs for a variety of possible reasons that include automation, a lowered cost of capital, scaling efficiencies, disintermediation, or improved matching and economic coordination. In these cases, the goods are being sourced at an economic advantage when compared to alternative off-chain processes. And the economic benefits of that blockchain implementation can then be shared and distributed among the participants of the economy in ways defined by the digital assets claims rights. Now, in the other case that the goods we assign to be claimable are exogenous, that means they have to be purchased or procured by other means from agents and entities that are external to the token economy. We can assume that unlike in the former case, there are no special economic advantages associated with these transactions in general. So to recap, we've just highlighted four distinctions that relate to two general attributes. First, we have the security of our claims, which in the best case is something we can secure automatically and trustlessly using smart contracts on a public blockchain. Redemptions of any other kind of asset claim will rely on processes or actions that are handled by a trusted intermediary. Then we have the question of how goods are sourced or originated. These may be sourced from within the digital asset economy endogenously, hopefully to some economic advantage, or they may have been sourced outside of the economy exogenously. And as you already see, these two pairs of properties are independent of each other. And that means we can fit them on a good old 2x2 matrix, as we see here. And I think this can be a useful aid to help organize our thinking about the digital asset claims in our own token economies that we're designing, or to analyze those of another project. We'll come back to this matrix again in a few moments after we explore how monetary actions can create value accrual. Just before we move on to that, it is very, very important to understand that there is one more claim right that is implicitly embedded in every blockchain token. You could think of it as a universal right of sorts. And that universal right is the right of exchange, which grants token holders an additional claim on exogenous value that's offered up by willing buyers of the token. This rides on a fundamental right of transfer granted by the blockchain protocol that users can exercise upon any tokens that are held in wallets that they control, as long as they pay any required fees. These default features are created by the blockchain and the token standard. They are not features that are created by the project design team. Now, even though these exchange rights effectively come in by default and they are not in the designer's control, they do need to be clearly understood since they have important implications for the other value accrual mechanics, both claims-based and monetary, because it will always be an option for token holders to simply sell, and that must be taken into account. All this links back to things I've said before about the importance of analyzing the existing or likely future composition of a project's demand in order to evaluate its value prospects. I argued that we have good reason to be wary of demand cases that are motivated by speculation outright or that are likely to be dominated by a speculator base in the future. When we examine these issues through the lens of digital asset claim rights, these speculation risks are signposted by value propositions that are dominated by the right of exchange, with few other meaningful claim rights being offered. But remember, it's also a risk if it's likely to be true that the user base is going to be captured by agents who disproportionately value the free right of exchange over any other claims rights being offered. Economies like these are almost certain to be prone to speculation or extraction. Okay, so that wraps up our initial discussion of how we can use claim rights to create value accrual. The other group of mechanisms which we can use to create value accrual are monetary in nature, actions that change the supply of tokens available at a given time. Luckily, this claims-based view that we've just been discussing helps to shed light on why supply affects token prices. Consider that well-designed claim rights will probably leave us in one of two situations, or a mix of the two. In the first case, we have a defined value pool that a number of tokens represents a fractional claim to. And if we hold the size of the value pool constant and increase the number of tokens, that represents a less valuable claim to a smaller fraction of the value pool. In this situation, we see that a smaller number of tokens makes each token more valuable and a larger number makes them less valuable. Unless there is growth in the value pool to match these increases in supply. In the second case, every token represents an unchanged commitment to a reliable claim on some other asset. In this situation, an increase in the asset supply has to be matched by a growth in the value pool, or else it rests on trust that the underlying economic process that's designed to support fulfillment of these claims will be able to continue doing so at this larger scale. In this situation, the increase in tokens can represent an increased cost burden on the economy of satisfying a higher number of claims, or an increase in the risk of all these claims being able to be satisfied on demand, or a decrease in the perceived value of the claim if there is not enough demand for the underlying asset it supplies. In all of these situations, a lower token supply is likelier to be more favorable to its value standing than a larger one, all else equal. And then there's one more channel that changes in supply can act through to affect price, and that's through the psychological responses to these changes in supply in market trading environments. These can create pricing effects that don't conform to traditional mathematical models of rationality and are the subject of study in behavioral economics and behavioral finance. But here again, the immediate scarcity of the asset can create a price impulse that is positive when the supply shrinks and negative when the supply increases. So whether we're talking about fundamental or behavioral effects of supply changes on pricing, the price responses all act in the same direction. If you hold other variables constant, decreased supply increases asset prices and its power to transact value. On the other hand, if you increase its supply, that lowers its asset price and its power to transact value. And that explains how monetary actions can be applied to function as a value accrual mechanism. And as before, it's a matter of project policy to decide whether these actions should be aiming for value preservation or value appreciation. So what makes for good value accrual design? Well, on the claim side, let's bring back our 2x2 matrix. It should be intuitively apparent that we're going to prefer claims that benefit from blockchain security. And we're also likely to prefer assets that are sourced endogenously within the economy, since they're likely to have cost advantages. Both of these areas overlap in the upper left quadrant, as shown. So if you have a blockchain project that has an economy and token claims that create access or delivery of value of these kinds of assets, I'd say you're on your way to having a strong proposal on your hands. And as I've said in other videos, I think blockchain genuinely offers lots of exciting opportunities in exactly this area. It's worth stressing that any fiat or stablecoin revenues that are generated by our digital asset economy should also be included as part of this top part of our matrix here, as endogenously sourced assets or resources. These are valuable to us for their properties of stable value storage and deep market liquidity, and they can also fund exogenous purchases. Now, it turns out that this is a very, very useful thing to be able to do, since it serves a secondary key goal for good value accrual design, which is diversification. And that's going to be the subject of our next video. Now, when it comes to evaluating monetary actions in accrual design, it's harder to draft up general guidelines for good practice. Some policy choices are just arbitrary or have merits that are heavily context dependent. Monetary actions can also be driven by the pursuit of other independent contradicting economic objectives, which include economic stimulus, growth financing, price stabilization, or even value redistribution between stakeholders. To the extent that we're discussing a project that is driving its monetary policies to prioritize value accrual concerns, the big risks to watch out for are avoiding inflationary spirals and deflationary spirals. In practice, deflationary spirals appear to be more of a theoretical possibility, and it is inflationary spirals that are proving all too frequent a problem. But getting this balance right is really hard to get right in practice. And that largely has to do with the fluctuations in market valuation that I warned you we need to be careful about. This can move for broader economic reasons that have absolutely zilch to do with the state or fundamentals of your own project's economy. To do this, we would either need to design some way to constrain these value flows, which would likely come at a cost to our economy since less value would choose to come in, or do our best to stress test and war game these mechanics to try and ensure that they function in the broadest set of possible circumstances and don't just leave us hanging there. This is another example of designing for diversification and resilience, which will be the focus of our next video lecture. And ladies and gentlemen, that is it. One final recap. Value accrual mechanics endow blockchain assets with value. Value properties are the combined result of claims rights conferred by our digital tokens and the quantity of them that are in circulating supply. Understanding the origin of token value in foundational detail will allow us to make design choices that will help us better manage the value of our assets in a sustainable fashion.